Well, thank you again for taking the time to come out tonight, and I'd like to introduce my boss and the executive director of Cooley Dickinson VNA and Hospice, Jean Ryan.
I think we're all here tonight to talk about a subject that's really meaningful to us, so it's important to get a look at who your presenters are. So, as Priscilla said, my name is Jean Ryan. I'm the executive director of the VNA and Hospice of Cooley Dickinson. I just want to say that we started doing these kinds of presentations several years ago. And sometimes we'd have 10 people, sometimes we'd have 5 people. But always there was so much passion and enthusiasm for the subject. But we never had a room that looked like this. Never. And I think, is that true? Have we ever had a room this crowded? Consider the Conversation. We had a room of about 85 people when we did an event called Consider the Conversation. And we watched a really poignant movie addressing how to have end-of-life conversations with your loved ones and family members. And it was held at Cooley Dickinson Hospital, of which we are a part. And I think that people felt like, oh, this is a health concern. If I have health concerns, then I should go to this Cooley Dickinson event. But I actually think now this topic has become a life concern. There are people in this room right now who are all ages, who want to be able to have these conversations, who want to understand what their options are, who want to understand sort of the legal implications for various options. And that's what we're here to talk about tonight. And primarily and mostly we'll be focusing on our medical orders for life-sustaining treatment, which is the pink form that you all have. People probably have questions, and we'll get to that at the end. We want to leave about 30 or 35 minutes for questions. So if you have them, jot them down so we can make sure we get to them. This is only the beginning. This isn't a one-shot deal. We're here for the long run, meaning we'll do this again and again and again. We have a training video that we've made for people in the community, such as yourselves and physicians and other healthcare practitioners, so they know how to have these conversations. It's not a drive-by conversation. It's a thoughtful, reflective conversation about what we each want, because we're all patients. We're all community members together. And so we'll give you access to that training video through our website. It's such a human thing to have a conversation. So that's what this is about. So I'll just say very briefly, this is Dr. Jeff Sessiger. He's our hospice and palliative care medical director. He'll be presenting next up. Following that, we have, let me get away from the microphone, we have Maureen Groden, who's the director of hospice and palliative care programs at Cooley Dickinson Healthcare, and that includes the VNA and Hospice of Cooley Dickinson. And then we have two folks who have been working with us, who this really matters to, and we have Don and we have Howard. And they'll be talking about their work with us, their experience. When you get to see the video that's up on our website, that will actually help you understand how to have these conversations with your doctor or healthcare practitioner, you'll actually see Howard, who stars in that video with Dr. Sessiger. And it wasn't an act. I mean, we had to get some acting in for the video, and they did it in one shot. I don't think there was one pause. So it's pretty amazing. I mean, they could do Breaking Bad probably if they wanted to. But anyway, So you'll see that and you'll understand sort of the work that we've been doing and also what's out there to help you. I don't want to spend too much more time because actually I'm not the reason you're here. The folks sitting at the table are the reason you're here. So we'll have about 30 or 35 minutes for questions. Jeff, I think you have to stand away from the other microphone. So I don't know if you want to come up here. Can everybody hear in the back? And thank you so much for coming and doing this great work with us.
Thank you all for coming. My heart does a double take when I see this many people interested in this topic. It's something that I've become passionate about in the last 20 years. I started in hospice then. I didn't even know in training there was such a thing as hospice. And then palliative care came along. And a very astute nurse I was working with said, hey, you have the right instincts for this. You ought to train. You ought to do that. And I said, well, what's the difference? So tonight I want to tell you a little bit about what's the difference. All of our panelists will give you more information. And in doing so, you get an idea, well, what kind of jobs do we do? How can we be helpful? And then we'll go on to the MOLST form to say, that piece of paper can give you a lot of control. So as a way of backup, we started in hospice because people who are near the end of their life have a lot of symptoms that need to be well managed. It could be pain or suffering of any type. Nobody wants that. And healthcare providers had no training. In medical school, I had no training in how to control pain. That's a zero. That was 1983 to 86 that I was in my formative years. So I learned after the fact, but people in training now are starting to learn from the ground up. So the next generation of healthcare providers is starting to have more skills, and I think that's great because I just turned 60. 20 years ago when I got into this, I said, oh yeah, that comes sometime. Well, no, it comes in all of our lives, and I can really see this is very, very important to me. I lost my mom a year ago, and I see my brothers and I all losing hair and going, well, we better think about this stuff. This is really a crucial thing. So with that as an intro, I do palliative care. I do hospice work. I work with Maureen very closely over at VNA and hospice. I work over at the hospital. And in doing so, I try to bring this kind of skill for making people more comfortable out to our community. The other thing we do is to say, what are your goals? So if somebody is uncomfortable, they become much more comfortable with the right care. Then the next question is, what are your goals? So tonight we'll go over goals, and that feeds right into the MOLST form also. And as we go along, if there's a burning question, you can answer it, but we have saved at least a half an hour or more at the end to be able to answer questions, and questions are great. So I think at this point I'll turn the mic over to Maureen. We tend to go back and forth and trade off on what we're doing. I should mention that if you two gentlemen would stand up, Don Reutner and Howard Nenner are with us tonight. And they're professors. They've retired. They've joined the cause, and they volunteer, and they freely give their time and energy and their outlook on what's life and how does this matter to any of us. Not from a medical point of view, but from a personal point of view. Thanks for standing up.
Hi, again, my name is Maureen Groden. Can you hear me okay? I'm going to start by talking to you about my mother, and then I'm going to tell you about the services that we have, so that'll, I think, help you understand about palliative and hospice. So the main messages we have tonight are that palliative care is not the same as hospice care, that if you need hospice care, the sooner the better. And it's very important that you actually have some advance directives or make decisions about how you would like to have your end of life care. So those are the three main messages. So my mother is 94 years old. About a year and 3 months ago, she was living in an independent apartment, and she was doing pretty well. She would go down to meals for, you know, supper, and she had a lot of family that were visiting, and she did a lot of things. She did jigsaw puzzles. She was, you know, she loved orchids, and she also loved to read. So if somebody asked her, what are your goals, her goal would be to find another good book to read. So then a day before her birthday, a year ago, she had a stroke, and it was fairly mild, but it did affect her ability to live on her own. So she went to the hospital, then went to a rehab facility, and then moved in with my brother Luke. So now she lives with my brother Luke, and she has 24/7 care. Thankfully, I'm from a big family, so we all chip in to help take care of her. About a year ago, she asked for a family meeting with a lot of my brothers and sisters, all of us actually. And actually, the reason why she had the meeting was because she wanted to talk about the fact that she wanted to fill out a form that said that she didn't want to be resuscitated. So she just wanted to make sure that all of us were okay with it. And actually, only one person was not okay with it. It was my brother. He happens to be a physician, and he just felt like, you know, why this can, you know, if it's something that can be fixed, why wouldn't you want to? The reality is that at the age of 93, 94, the chance of success from cardiopulmonary resuscitation isn't as good as it is on TV. So my mom felt like anything that serious, I would have a really hard time recovering from. So after the meeting, we all, you know, she decided that, and we all said, fine, you know, my other sister, who's a doctor, sort of, you know, helped have everybody understand that. So now she felt happy that she actually had a do not resuscitate form. Then what happened was the MOLS form came out, which Dr. Zesser is going to talk about tonight, and the MOLS form allows her to say, I don't want to be hospitalized, and that was extremely important to her. So she went to the doctor and actually had the MOLS form filled out. And then what ended up happening is she's now getting care pretty much around the clock with our family and then one hired person. And she's not particularly happy because she can't do what she used to be able to do. She can't read. She can't do jigsaw puzzles anymore. She can't, you know, she's not living on her own, and she's not particularly happy. So I don't know if it's because I'm in hospice and palliative care that she felt comfortable talking to me. Because some of the other people in the family say they don't, you know, when she starts to say, I hate this, or I'm sick of this, or I don't like living like this, they're not as comfortable talking about it. So I say, yeah, Mom, that must be tough, you know, or is there anything I can do to make things easier for you, or would you like to talk to somebody, would you like to do whatever? So we had a little talk the other day about, you know, what are your choices? She doesn't think it's a choice for her to stop eating. She just feels like religiously and otherwise, that's not a choice for her. So right now we do whatever we can to help her with her quality of life. But she at least feels comfortable that she has a do not resuscitate, do not hospitalize. And so she goes to her doctor and she has made a decision. I'm not gonna bother to have a mammogram because what am I gonna do if they find something? So a lot of people are in the same place as this, only they have a serious illness like congestive heart failure, emphysema, kidney disease, cancer. And what happens is they're in the position where they're trying to make decisions about, do I still want to do this? I don't know if it's worth it anymore. My mother went to have a blood test done, and she said to me, they actually just did this blood test at another doctor's office last week. And I said, well, Mom, you don't have to have it done again. And she said, they all want their own. So I think the important message is that the birthing movement in this country changed, where partners went into delivery rooms, doulas were hired, people made choices about what they wanted for their birth. I think that the healthcare system has, you know, protocols for what happens when you're this, that, and everything else, that it's important that you all give some thought and make decisions about what you want. And palliative care is able to help with those kind of choices, because palliative care is a specialty. People that are in palliative care have a specialty in pain management, symptom management, restlessness, difficulty breathing. You might think that everyone in the healthcare system should have that expertise, but they actually don't. A lot of people that have a serious illness have a cardiologist, sometimes a endocrinologist, sometimes they have a PCP or a primary care provider. So there's a lot of coordination that has to happen. So the palliative care program is for people that have a serious illness that need a higher level of coordination so that there aren't gaps and duplications in our healthcare system that will shepherd people through the kinds of care that they need. They're still getting active treatment. They're still very much getting whatever they choose to have done. It's very much your choice to have what you want done. But someone's there to say, do I really need this? When you ask somebody who has a serious illness, what are your goals? And they're still very much on the treatment track of going to the hospital, going to the physician's office and such. They almost always will say a functional goal. I want to get to the mailbox. I want to sit on the porch. I want to drive again. So our palliative care program at the VNA is very focused on rehab. We have physical therapists, occupational therapists, speech therapists that help people with the goal of getting better, getting stronger. It's not the same as hospice. Hospice team is focused on more support care. So we have a spiritual counselor. We have volunteers. We have a lot of support services because these folks generally have a 6-month or less prognosis, And most of the time, their goal is to stay home and be comfortable. So we have two teams at the VNA in hospice. One's focused on palliative, one's focused on hospice. We have Dr. Zessiger at Cooley Dickinson, who actually does inpatient consults for palliative care. So can sit with you to help clarify the goals and then make decisions around what kind of care you want based on your goals. And then he also has an outpatient clinic at Cooley where he can see folks there too. So that's kind of an overview of palliative care and hospice. Thank you.
And I'd say one more thing on what Maureen was saying. When people think about hospice, it's usually somebody in the last 6 months or so of their life. People that get onto the hospice support group here in town, though, on average are on for a couple weeks, maybe a few weeks. So people are so afraid of hospice that they often say, not now, I'll do it later. In comes palliative care, and it helps because we can give a lot of support earlier, and then I notice when people meet other people and you say, oh, you're not a scary person, you're not hospice or palliative care, you're a person who's here to help me, you're coming to my house or I'm going to visit you. Once you're a real person, the fear drops off and now somebody's there to help you. So that's what this is all about. When you're sick, when you have a serious illness, it's not, oh, I have a little high blood pressure. Oh, maybe I've had a skin cancer. It's something bigger, something serious that can really affect your life. That's when palliative care gets involved. We come and go, and we're there for you when you need it. We go in the background when you don't. Later on, years later, you might say, oh, I need you again. If it's a really serious illness, though, oftentimes people may only live for months or years. Still, that's quite a long time. We want you to be comfortable and have the best strength to get around and do what you want to do. So that's where the rehab focus is really intense. We do it outpatient. We do it through the VNA. And that way, people get back on their feet. So that's what I see as the difference. In hospice, you'll have 6 months or so, maybe, of life left. In palliative care, months or years. And we want you to be at your best. What I want to go to next, though, is the MOLST form, because this gives you a piece of paper where you can put what your wishes are, and this comes in very handy in many ways. Before I go to this, I'm going to ask a show of hands in the audience. How many people have heard of MOLST before? You are the acolytes out there in the community. How many people have a healthcare proxy form? The cameras aren't on you, but that was almost everybody. Perfect. Anybody 18 or older could and probably should have a healthcare proxy in case something happens suddenly. But the MOLST form, our bright pink Pepto-Bismol form here, is a little different. It's not who do I want to speak for me if I'm sick and I can't tell you what I want. It's what are my wishes in general given my health status right now. So you would gladly do this at home, fill it out, write notes on it, put questions on it, look on the internet, there's lots of information, and then you go to your physician, your nurse practitioner, your doctor, your PA, any one of the three in the state of Massachusetts can sign this form. You don't need a lawyer, you don't need several witnesses. You do need witnesses on the healthcare proxy. On the MOLST form, you just need you and your main doctor. If you would, look up in the top on the left. There's a shaded area there. What you'll see is www.molst-ma.org. That's the site you may want to go to because it has more information, and one of the greatest parts is frequently asked questions. So whatever you hear tonight, you might say, but they never mentioned fill in the blank. They might have it right on the MOLST website. You can also go to the National MOLST forums. There's a lot of information out there, but this is a really good one to get started on. As you notice on this form, there's two sides. I'll go over them in sequence because the front side tends to be the most important. I have some people that don't even fill out the back. They don't want to go there. Direct your attention, if you would. On the left side, there's a column saying A, B, C, D. on A, that pertains to the line to the right of it, and it talks about cardiopulmonary resuscitation, CPR. So anybody that's had basic life support knows that's pushing on someone's chest to try to get their heart to beat a little bit and push blood around. They also, less so now than years ago, if there are two people doing the support for CPR, somebody might be breathing for you at the same time. Particularly on this form, though, this talks more about your heart than really doing invasive things for your breathing. So push on the chest, maybe some breaths. If there were an emergency crew there, they could, if your heart rate was funny or stopped, they'd put paddles on and give a shock or two. That's part of this first line. So I have people that tell me, why wouldn't I do that? You can, but I have some women who have terrible osteoporosis. And they say, don't get near me pushing on my ribs. I know that's not going to be fun at all. I may get through it, but I'm going to have so many broken bones, I'll hate it. So you have to tailor your choices with your physician, depending on what your illness is or your strengths are. There are other people that say, you know, my heart's so weak, I don't think it could get through a resuscitation from that. I don't want it. But I have a lot of people that say, sure, this right now for me, I might have a kidney ailment, I might have a lung and arthritis, whatever the combination, but I'd want you to do the heart part. So it gives you a lot of choice. If you go to B now, B gets into the breathing side specifically. You'll notice it says do not intubate and ventilate or intubate and ventilate. We're talking with these intubations, putting down a breathing tube like you'd have if you went to surgery and they gave you anesthesia. So a tube would go down your throat through the mouth or your nostril down to the top of your lungs, and then you would get put on a machine to breathe for you. We see this used a lot when somebody has a pneumonia. In flu season, we use it more. It may be the perfect thing for you. It might get you over the hump of an acute illness. But if I take a different patient who has a terrible lung disease, maybe cancer in the lung, maybe emphysema also, those are the people that might tell me, I don't want to be on that machine. I did it once before. It wasn't fun at all. The recovery was tough. I don't want to do that. So this line lets you say, sure, I'd want that, or no, I wouldn't. Right below it, you'll notice there's something called non-invasive ventilation. Non-invasive means that something didn't go into your body. It's really a tight-fitting mask, kind of like an aqualung mask if you're scuba diving, in the real old-fashioned one. Goes over your nose and mouth, and it puts a seal on that area to push air down into your lungs. Without it, some people can't breathe. With it, some people say, okay, it rests my breathing muscles and lets me get over a pneumonia or a bronchitis. It doesn't work well if you have a really serious illness that's not acute, suddenly hitting you, but it's built up, gotten worse and worse over months and years. It may not get you over that hump because there is no hump. You're just in a spot where your lungs are failing. So when I talk to my patients, they say, which camp am I in? Should I consider using this or not? And then I give them advice. They listen to me, they go home, they talk to their families, and then they decide for themselves, I think I do want that, or maybe I don't. And then they come back and we talk about it again. The third line here, this is where Maureen's mom weighed in and said, I want something that keeps me out of the hospital. I've been there enough. It's not going to have anything for me that I want, except I'm not going to be home. I'm not going to be around family. I'll be in a scary place and a lot of people doing tests on me. So for her to choose this, it's great. Before this form, we had no way to say that. People that are on hospice tend to tell us, please, I don't want to go back to the hospital. I'd say that's 99% of the people. Here, anybody with a serious illness fills this out. You can say, nope, I don't want to go to your hospital. If you do check that, or your loved one checks that, I would say you need to have a really, really good plan for what happens if you're home and suddenly you're short of breath, or you're home and you've got a lot of pain. So mostly people that check that are people that are ready with a plan, or they have hospice supporting them, so there's a really good team and a support plan in place. The second half of this form is just for signatures. You can see, you can check a box saying you're the patient, the healthcare agent, which in Massachusetts, healthcare proxy, the guardian, or a parent if you were choosing for a minor who was very sick. At the bottom of the form, you'll see this form does not expire unless stated. Very, very rarely somebody will say, for the next 2 months while I'm going through chemotherapy, here are my wishes. Once I get through it, I may change this form, and I want to have a date that it stops working. I've not had anybody ask me for that. Under it, though, you see there's who's your healthcare agent, that's your proxy, and who your primary doctor is. Flip, if you would, over to the other side. On the second side, you'll notice we're using some of the same words that we did on the first. Intubation and ventilation comes up. We're not asking it to get a different answer. We're asking it to say, would you want that treatment, but short-term only? So I have people that have said to me, oh, I need that breathing tube. If I need it for 2 weeks or 2 months, that's fine. Do it. And then I need to tell them what that means. And it means, well, if you need the breathing machine and the breathing tube for a couple weeks, you need to have a tracheotomy. So surgically, you'd have to have a hole opened in your neck and a tube put in so you could hook up to get breathing that way. Sometimes when I mention that to people, they go, oh, that's not what I meant. I wanted you to keep me alive because I really value being alive, but I wouldn't want that. If someone tells me that, I'll tell them, well, you don't really want what you said on the first side exactly to intubate and ventilate. You want to intubate and ventilate short-term only. Look in the middle column, and it says, use intubation and ventilation as marked in Section B, but short-term only. We purposely in the state kept this term vague because we don't want to say 3 days, 1 week, whatever it is. This allows your treatment team and your family to talk and say, are we making progress? If so, the intent of checking short-term is to get over that hump. If you're over the hump, you're getting better, that's exactly what you want. You may need to go to rehab. You may need to take it easy when you get home, but that pneumonia is clearing. So I notice most people check short-term only. That gives them what they want, an aggressive approach to trying to get them better, but not to keep them dependent on a machine, which almost nobody says is a great way to live. Going down the next step, it's very similar. The next line says non-invasive ventilation. Also gives you the option for short-term only. The mask is not very comfortable. It's hard to speak at all. You can't eat when you have the mask on. You'd have to take it off, eat something, and then put the mask back on. It's pretty difficult to do, but sometimes people say, I'd like to try that for a few days. Again, short-term only would be the way to do that. You'll notice, if you would, look to the right column. I haven't mentioned the right column on this back side of the page, but it says things like undecided or did not discuss. That allows you, if you're in a conversation with your physician, to say, well, I don't know about that one. Check the box, say I'm undecided. Perfectly fine. We can do another one of these later. We have a million of these forms around. You just need to update it. Next down on that list is dialysis. Usually we don't mention it too much, although some people say, boy, my cousin was on dialysis. I know what that's like. I would never want it. But it gives you the same options. Would you use it? Would you use it short-term only? Or undecided, or just didn't discuss? Under that is two of the feeding options. The first is, what about food? If you couldn't swallow, how would you get nutrition? You're trying to get better. Well, if you're just weak, you're at the end of your life, you might say, I don't really need to eat a lot. I'll eat a bite here and there. I want to eat the things I love, and give me champagne and caviar. Whatever the, by the way, most of the hospice nurses say, give me chocolate. I've just given away a big secret. So, on artificial nutrition, it really depends what your goal is. So again, a good conversation with your healthcare provider leads you down a path to say, here's what's important to me. I want to try to get better. My swallowing's getting worse. You may have had a stroke. You may have general weakness. There are muscles in your esophagus that help you swallow. Without them, or if they're not working well, it's really hard to swallow, or the food goes down your lung and you get a pneumonia. In those cases, you have to say, would I want to have intravenous fluids that would give me extra nutrition? That's called total parenteral nutrition, TPN. Would I want a feeding tube even? A feeding tube gives the best nutrition. It would be put at the top of the stomach, goes through the skin, into your stomach, and then you feed by having cans of or bags of food. Some people say, I don't really care about eating. It was never a big deal for me. If I can live well, it gives me the energy, that's what I want. They would say, sure, use artificial nutrition. They wouldn't put a time limit on it. Other people might tell me, well, I would do it for a short time, but I don't think I'd want to go without eating and going out with my friends. That's one of my greatest pleasures. I want to go out to eat with them. They would say either no or use it for a short term only. So it lets you tailor, again, what's right for you. The last one is artificial hydration, and that just means IV fluids. So IV fluids, I pretty much tell everybody I know that asks me about this form, you would probably want to check yes to IV hydration, short-term only, because it won't keep you alive and living with good energy if it's just IV fluid. It's just a little salt and a little sugar. There's one little spot left to talk about on this form. Right below that, you'll see there's a couple of lines that are blank. These allow you to say, well, in your infinite wisdom, people in Massachusetts, in the legislature and DPH, you didn't mention the one thing I want to write on this form. Here's where you can write it. It used to be we would say, well, you could write a living will, but a living will isn't legal in Massachusetts. So you can do it, and it gives you an idea, and your physician's an idea what your wishes are. But not being legal, we came up with this. So you could easily say, I wouldn't want to fill in the blank, whatever that is. Or please do this for me. This is important. You might say, pain doesn't bother me, but having spiritual support really is important to me. You would put that. So whatever your wish is, that's where you can put it. Below that, you'll see there's a place to sign again, and that's the MOLS form. So it gives a lot of control, and I think this is the time I'd like to hand the mic over to Howard, because he says a few things from a personal point of view. Well, how does this thing really work?
Let me start by saying that I am delighted, I am gratified, I am thrilled to see such a large audience. But it's not merely because of the size, although that is a large part of it. I'm delighted because you represent a very important paradigm shift. Let me explain. For the last several years, a group of us, which I irreverently refer to as the doctor, the nurse, and the three stooges, have been going around the valley, mostly to senior centers, retirement homes, and talking basically about palliative care. And what we have found, or at least what we think we have found, is that that's safer ground than talking about end-of-life care. People don't want to hear about end-of-life care. I've doubted that for a long time. And your presence here, I think, underscores the fact that there are people who do want to hear about it, who do want to think about it. So having said that, let's take a look at what kinds of choices you have. I'm not speaking to you specifically, but I'm speaking about a room roughly this size with a number of people in it. A small percentage, and it will be a small percentage, will have no choice in the matter of how they die. And that's because they will be struck by a massive heart attack, a massive stroke, they will be in an accident, and it'll be all over before they can exercise a choice. But the majority, the great majority of us, will have a choice about how we die. The problem is that most of us within that group who have a choice ordinarily don't exercise the choice. They don't want to think about what's going to happen and when it's going to happen. And that's what this is all about, what we're talking about here tonight. And Dr. Zesiger, having gone through the Moltz form, which is a critical form for you to go over and to fill out with your physician. If you're like me, and I've been through this now 20, 30, 40 times in groups of this size, I've looked at this form hundreds of times, and I'm here to tell you, I'm still not sure how to fill it out. What I know is that when I fill it out, I need to fill it out in consultation with my physician. And I know the best way to do that, which is to take not the final form, but a working copy of the form, fill it out as best you can, and then make an appointment to see your physician and go over it with the physician. MOLTS stands for Medical Orders for Life-Sustaining Treatment. But the thing in this particular case that's important that I want to emphasize is that these are medical orders. This has no validity unless it is signed by a doctor or some other authorized health care provider. You go along, you sign it, but it's the doctor or the health care provider whose signature really counts in putting this through. That still is not going to make it a whole lot easier. I said that there are in this room statistically a majority of people who will have a choice about how they die, but may not exercise that choice. Let me give you roughly some sense of what that means. In point of fact, if you do nothing and you do not die suddenly, the chances are almost overwhelmingly that you're going to die in a nursing home or a hospital. That's just the way our system is set up. And if I were to ask you, because I don't even have to bother to ask you because I know the answer. We've done this any number of times. If you have a choice about where you're going to die, where do you want that to be? Overwhelmingly, people say, well, at home. That's where I want to die. I want to die in comfort. I want to die in the company of people who are important to me. I want to go out easily. Sure, you want it. But unless you do something about it, you're going to be caught up in a system that is not really set up to facilitate that desire. That's why this Moltz form is so important. That's why you have to start thinking about what it is that you want. It's not an easy thing to do. And as I said, you may not, after you leave here, after you've heard Dr. Zesiger and others go through it, you still may be very confused. I know I am. I still don't know what I want. And what I also think I know is that I could easily think I know what I want and then change my mind. I'm reminded of one of my favorite cartoons that appeared years ago. I tend to see life through cartoons as metaphors for all kinds of things. And the cartoon is a very simple one. It's two convicts in the exercise yard of a prison. And one says to the other, you know, I always swore that they'd never take me alive. But when the time came, I said, what the hell? The point is that you don't know, in most cases, what you're going to do when the time comes, and you may not have the opportunity to exercise that choice when it is upon you, which is why we encourage you to think about it now. keep in mind, too, that anything you do decide working with your physician about things you want and things that you don't want are not fixed and unchangeable. You can change them at any time. You can give a whole recitation about everything you want. And then when the time comes and they're wheeling you into the hospital, you can say, stop the press, I changed my mind. Tear up that form, and you were perfectly privileged to do it. It's your decision, you're in control of it. And what we're here to try to help you do is to make as informed a decision as possible.
Is this still working? I want to thank the panel for covering almost everything that it's possible to cover. So I'm going to do something that I've never done before at one of these forums, and that's try and give you a framework in which you can place all of this information, and there's a great deal of it. Closer? Better? And there are a number of reasons for doing that, and Howard has mentioned a number of them. Things change. You get older. What you want to do changes. What you wish to have happen to you changes. And if you have a framework that you can use to think about these things, it sometimes helps. So here's what I was thinking about. End-of-life issues are very complicated, but they seem to me to fall into three general categories: communication, comfort, and control. Communication should take place, as has been mentioned tonight, with your family, your doctor, your healthcare proxy. But it shouldn't happen just once. It should continue to happen as you age, as your wishes change, as you think about life a little bit differently. Comfort also changes. What would you like to be able to do? How would you like to feel? And again, that changes as you get older. That's the second category that I think a lot of the information that you've heard tonight falls into. And the last one is essentially control. And that's very important. And Jeff has mentioned, and Howard has mentioned, how the MOLST form allows you to gain control. You can fill it out once, but when things change, you can fill it out again. You can fill it out as many times as you want to. And you can fill it out so that it meets your needs, so that from the communication that you've had with your family, friends, your healthcare proxy, you've got some information from those discussions that will help you fill that out in the ways that allow you to feel most comfortable with it. So given all the complexities of this, and I'm sure things may get more complex as the healthcare system changes, I just thought it would be worthwhile to sort of have a framework for end-of-life thoughts. And the three, again, are communication, control, and comfort.
So what we want to do now is to move into the question and answer session. And as I was sitting here, I was thinking that there are a number of people sitting up at the table who have various forms of expertise. And we're often in an audience like this where people have expertise and we're learning from them. But I guess the takeaway message for all of us, because we all will leave this world, is that you're the expert, you and your family. There's no one right way. What feels right for me and for my family is right for me and for my family. And that is different for every single person. And we're here to give you tools that you need to do it the right way, which is your way, as much control as you can have and what you want, et cetera. So I don't know if there's a microphone that can be passed around, but what I will do is to repeat the question and then just hand the microphone to folks. Yeah, if you want to pass questions over to Priscilla, we can do that. Folks want to. So what we could do is to start with some of those questions from the index cards. Does that work for folks? Okay. So what I'll do is I'll read out the questions from the index cards. I brought my glasses. And then we'll let the folks on the panel answer. Okay? Okay, so the first question is, what if you don't have a serious illness yet? Should you fill out a MULST? Sounds like a Jeff question.
Well, that's a good one to start with. The answer is, there's nothing in the law that says you can't fill it out today. So all I've heard from the people who are running the MULST in the state of Massachusetts is, well, if you don't have a serious illness, you don't really know what you want or don't want. I disagree a little. I think people should have the choice to say what they want today, and as Howard and Don said, change it as much as you want, as often as you want. All you have to do is write void on it, both sides. You don't tear it up, you keep it in your file, or better yet, you keep it on your refrigerator, maybe in an envelope if you don't want a big bright pink thing there. But when you change it, just write a new one. The newer date is the one that we'll listen to and will be recognized at the hospital or anywhere else. So I would say fill it out anytime that you want to. Put your wishes down.
I just want to remind people, too, that some of the biggest landmark cases that had to do with disagreements around family members were not people that had a serious illness, but they had a serious accident. So there might be a situation where you decide that, yes, I definitely want CPR, ventilation, all of this, but not long term. So that would be an opportunity for you to make it clear to your family and to your physician that if there was a serious accident, that that's not what you would want.
Thanks, Maureen. That might actually answer this next question. Oh, I'm sorry, did you have something to add? Did I miss anybody? Okay, so the question is, what if you say do not intubate, thinking it is for end of life, and next week you get in a bike accident that affects your lungs and you'll die without a breathing tube? So I think that's what you were talking about, but go ahead.
And certainly what if you were in the emergency room going, boy, I can't breathe, and the doctor said, well, I see this MULST form that you brought in, or the emergency room ambulance brought in. All you have to do is, even if you can't say, you can say, you point to your throat. One of my favorite intensive care doctors at Cooley just said, I listen to people, they can point, I know what they mean. They mean put the breathing tube down. That's fine. So if you were unconscious, then that's when your healthcare proxy would come in and say, well, doc, tell me about this situation. Is this a reversible thing? Oh, it is. What would it take? Gee, that makes sense. If I know my brother, my friend, my sister, they would say yes. And that healthcare proxy supersedes this. They would certainly say, if you're in the hospital not getting better, they'd bring up the form again and say, are we sure we're doing the right thing? Your loved one said this before. So it's a work in progress. So nothing is absolute unless you were in the emergency room, nobody around to say anything for you, and the form was there. They would say, all right, this looks like what he wants or she wants. We'll follow that.
I just want to underscore and emphasize what you've been hearing, and which is that you do have a choice. Let me just say something that should be obvious but may not be. If you have a MULST form that is valid and you were brought into the hospital or you are taken in by an ambulance to the hospital, the fact that you have a MULST form doesn't necessarily mean that it's going to be used, because so long as you are able to say, hey, I want this, I don't want that, please try this, please don't try that, that overrides anything that the MULST form has to say. I would also point out, we just went over this briefly, but I think this is extremely important, that the first and most important thing that you need to do, and most of you have already done it, is that you have filled out a healthcare proxy form designating a healthcare agent. That is so fundamentally important. I know, and I'm sure everyone around at this table knows, and many of you in the audience know, of cases in which an individual is in a position as a patient and needing some important decisions to be made about his or her ongoing treatment. and he or she is unable to communicate, and there is no healthcare agent that has been designated, and so the family can now settle down to a real fight about, hey, let's do this, no, let's not do this. You want to avoid that at all costs. You want to be sure that you've designated somebody who you trust and who is willing to make that decision, but again, only in the circumstances where you are unable to do it.
And I just wanted to mention that most of you said you had a healthcare proxy. The healthcare proxy form does not have to be signed by an attorney or a doctor. It has to be witnessed by two people. So that's important to know. And also to choose somebody for the healthcare proxy that you really do trust will carry out your wishes. As you know, every single brother and sister, son and daughter gets along perfectly. So it's important that you pick somebody that you feel will really honor your wishes.
That's great, thank you. So this is kind of a longish question. The traditional advance directive provides a means to communicate one's treatment wishes in advance of the terminal illness and when a MULS form would be inappropriate. And people are referring to the, I think, a DNR, or comfort care order. Okay.
So what I think we're trying to get is the definition of an advance directive long form. And I know we've had the resuscitate or don't resuscitate. That's very short. We've had the living will, which is quite long.
Okay.
Living will. So a living will says, if this situation occurred, I would want this done. If that situation, like pneumonia, stroke, sudden heart attack that's leaving me not able to fend for myself, what would my wishes be? So that's one way to approach things, and there's online sources where you can download things that discuss that. But again, in Massachusetts, it's not a legal form. Given that, MULS form, pretty condensed, pretty small, but it does give you the power of choosing most things.
I think the problem is that the most form is intended for someone who is terminally ill. I mean, it says in the instructions who should fill out the form. It's for someone who is at end of life or.
Actually, no. It's the word they tend to use is serious illness. So the same serious illness that we say would qualify somebody for palliative care is the kind of person that would want to fill out the MULS form.
Okay, all right. Well, what about the person who has no serious illness and is able to express their wishes about what they would want done were they to become unable to communicate, who and then becomes unable to communicate? How do you communicate the living will type issues if your surrogate is not available? You know, we've just come from Pennsylvania where the private physician had the living will in his or her file and could follow that. How do you bridge that gap in Massachusetts?
In Massachusetts, what I would do, because there was no MULS form for the first, 25 plus years I've been in town. So I would ask people, well, what would you want and what's important to you, and get an idea, and then I would interpret that when they came in the hospital. But at this point, there's a lot of people that are part of your healthcare team. One person you might tell, maybe they're on vacation. There's no way of sharing that. If you had a living will, and I saw the living will, I would have no problem looking at it and saying, you are telling me what things you want and don't want. If there were a healthcare proxy at the same time, or you didn't have one but you had family or friends that were close, I'd say, this is evidence that you've gone through some trouble to tell me what you want. It's not legal, and the reason to have legal is when there's a disagreement. So we were saying, if you have two brothers that are saying totally opposite things, how do you decide? You would have to get a guardian appointed in the law, in the courts, and that takes time, and that's a mess. So any one of these forms, including a living will, which isn't legal, but if I saw a living will and I were taking care of you and your son number one said, follow that and the other one said don't, you would go to our ethics committee. We would have a big discussion. We'd bring in a lawyer if we had to try to make sure your wishes are upheld. So it's not legal, but I do notice that it's very helpful. So bring in your living will, too. That's okay. It cannot.
Let me see if I can refine that a little bit. When Dr. Zesiger says it's not legal, what he really means to say is it is not legally binding. It is not an illegal document. It is a good indication of what you want. But what might happen, and in the absence of anything other than just this advance directive that you filled out in Pennsylvania or wherever, which is not legally binding in Massachusetts, is that if you were taken to a hospital with something that was life-threatening and choices had to be made as to what your treatment would be, and all they had was this document that you had executed 2, 3, 5, 10 years ago, whenever, in another state, the people in the hospital would be within their rights to say, yeah, that's what he thinks he wants, but we know better. What we're going to do is, because we're bound to help people, to cure them, to try to keep him alive, even though at some point in the past, he didn't seem to think that he wanted it. What I'm suggesting is that in most circumstances, that advance directive will be followed, but you can't be certain of it, that it can be overridden. And so the Maltz form really takes the place of that advance directive.
To appear argumentative. I'm trying very hard to clarify the circumstance because, at the present time, many of us do not have a significant illness, and we can speak, we can talk, we can say what we want. But we might become incompetent. We might, for example, I might have a myocardial infarction, have a cardiac arrest. I would certainly want resuscitated the first time. I would not fill out a Maltz form to say no resuscitation. But at some point, if brain death occurs and my medical surrogate is not available, I would not want to be resuscitated if there were a cardiac arrest again. So how do you, and then I would want comfort care, and there would be a long list of things on the living will form that I would want to not be done. How do you communicate that with legal binding now?
The answer.
Go ahead, I don't think you need a microphone.
Okay, the answer is you can do all that on the Maltz form.
Okay.
You know, where it says on the Maltz form on the back part, where there it says other treatment preferences specific to the patient's medical condition and care, don't think you're restricted to those 2.5 lines. I would suggest to you, in your particular case as you've described it, I'd say execute a Maltz form and append your living will document to that.
Well, will that be then legally binding?
Yes, absolutely.
Okay, that's the answer.
So long as it's on here.
Yeah.
So here's the thing. Thank you so much, because you just see that this is not a one-shot deal. Every question, there are deeper questions and deeper questions. So when I say we're here for the long haul, I don't mean tonight. And I say that in all seriousness. I mean, one time, Jeff and I went to Applewood, and Jeff said, we'll stay here all night if you want. And I said, no, we won't. That's true. Is that right? I'm not even making that up. But anyway, the point is that a couple of things. Please write down on your index cards, if you still have any. Is this right, Priscilla? And we'll pass them out. Other topics you want us to come back and go over. And sir, I see that your hand is raised. Is it a question? Okay, so hang on. So what we have, and I put them all in order, is every card that came up here, I drop them according to the order I received them in. This was just Priscilla telling me to ask people to write down what other topics they wanted. I'd like to continue to go in order with the index cards if that works for people, knowing we'll come back next month if you want. We'll come back every month. Pardon me? Then ask your question.
The question is quite, it has nothing to do with what we've talked about so far. However, we have a number of hospitals in this area and elsewhere under different religious banners. And there have been any number of arguments put forth of things that these hospitals do not want to do, whether it has to do with abortion, whether it has to do with distribution of contraceptives. And I am wondering, despite all of the well thought out material that you have here, what happens if a person ends up, maybe as a result of an accident, the nearest ER? And what is the how do you get around the attitude of the hospital toward this form being brought in and say, well, we don't do that here?
Okay, thank you.
Yeah, I'll take that one. You'll notice in the last month, month and a half, there have been a couple of cases in the country where wishes weren't being followed. You had to go through legal means to do it. It's still going to happen. But the goal of this forum and these discussions, and then your discussions with your healthcare proxy or proxies may have a backup, is to say, here's what's important to me. Are you willing to fight for me? So you may have two sons that say, oh, I know what you want, Dad. Sure, I'll do it. You better pick the one that's the tough as nails one, because they may have to go toe to toe and say, you're not listening to me. This is what I need. And they'll advocate. So whether you're in this or that hospital, they may have different policies. You can always ask to be transferred to another hospital. Even from the emergency room, there's a federal law that says if you need to be transferred, you just ask and you go. So this, you have some protections. You have to speak up and just make sure somebody speaks up for you if you're not able to.
Is there a way to put that into practice as a part of your delivery when you talk to people, as you have now?
Your question,
that's rather important.
Is there a way to put it into practice? You do it by choosing your healthcare proxy carefully, your doctor carefully, and making sure they know what you want.
But until I raised the question, you made no mention about that hospital which has some serious...
Some hospitals have reservations on providing certain care, but most of that isn't going to be something that gets in the way of your wishes on a MOLS form. Once in a while it is, and those are national cases. You hear about them. But how many have you heard about in the last 10 years? I could count them on a hand or two. So most people, 99.9% of people that fill out a form like this, they get what they want. It really works. And we've seen it in action already.
Thanks, Jeff. So what I want to do is I want to say that we have a stack like this. And we're clearly not going to get through all of these. And individual concerns are really valid and important, but they're hard to handle in a group setting like this. So I'm trying to move us on without being disrespectful to anybody in the group. So know that some of you might be thinking, okay, let's stop that person or let that person talk longer. I'm just trying to navigate this situation with dignity for all, knowing that this is a great topic, but it's a hard topic. People have a lot of passions about it. So we will be back if we haven't, we're not leaving yet. If we haven't answered your question, you can email us. Priscilla, can people message us on Facebook with questions we didn't answer? Because we're clearly not going to get through this stack in the next 17 minutes.
So you can message us on Facebook. You can post a question on our Facebook page. Or if you go to our website, which is vnaandhospice.org, you can. There's a contact us form that's confidential, and it actually comes straight to me. So you can send me any questions you have.
So we'll try to do our best to get through these with dignity and respect for each other's opinions and thoughts. So can a healthcare proxy override a MULST? If Everyone heard that? Can a healthcare proxy override a MULST if you get sick and you don't want to be hospitalized, but your healthcare proxy needs you to be hospitalized? I think that's kind of what it meant, yeah? Jeff?
The answer, the short answer is yes, your healthcare proxy can override your MULST. And the reason is they have a brain. You've entrusted them to follow wishes that you want, whereas this piece of paper is a static thing until you update it. When you did this, you had no idea that you were about to have XYZ illness. You might be unconscious, and your son, your daughter, your friend may say, I know, I talked to them about this, but they never envisioned this particular situation. I think, as they talk to the doctor in the emergency room, if we did such and such a treatment, the chance of success is big. The chance of problems that would lead to this person living a life they wouldn't want to lead are very small. Go ahead and do it. Later on, do you have people getting mad at you? You might. But somebody recently told me, in families and in teams that work closely together, we all carry the scars of doing that. We do. In families, we work together. Your healthcare proxy will work with you. Will they sometimes make the mistake? They could. But they have a brain. They can listen to reason. And they can say, I think the intent of this MULST form would allow this deviation to get my loved one where I think they should be. So yes, a healthcare proxy can overrule. But again, if they're saying something crazy and we have this form, maybe we got a copy from their doctor, we're going to sit down with them right away and say, let's tell me why you think we should do this when the form clearly, legally says the other. And if there's a real disagreement between the doctors, the nurses, we'll again have an ethics committee meeting. We'll do that quite urgently. Or we'll call the hospital lawyer and say, we have a serious problem starting up here. And the hospital administrator would be on call. They would come in. So we'll have a very intense conversation right up front if need be. And that can happen just about any time.
Thanks, Sam. Sure. Go ahead, Maureen.
I just wanted to mention something you said made me think of something. Most of the research that's coming out now is showing that if you have a serious illness and you have palliative care or hospice, your chance of having a better quality of life is higher and your chance of living longer is actually better. The reality is if you're frail, you have a serious illness, and you have cancer, heart disease, whatever, treatment sometimes can be harmful. That if you're on that fine balance when you're trying to decide whether this is a benefit or a burden, then you can get infections in hospitals. You can have a lot of treatment, either blood test and testing. You're not in your own bed. You're not eating your own food. You're not around the people that love you and so forth. So that's just important to remember, that those decisions that have to be made sometimes can be very difficult decisions. And having somebody who has a background in palliative care can help you make those decisions, because those decisions are usually based on your goals and not on what is the treatment protocol for this particular situation. That doesn't always individualize the care to what are your goals.
So just let me get to this next question. Hang on one second, Howard, because I think this is a great follow-up, and somebody has asked just a comment, and I think we actually have. So it says, the alternative to the MULST form is to discuss with the healthcare proxy, they said agent, but it's the healthcare proxy, various scenarios, and let him or her make the decisions. Thus, the control is with the agent and not the doctor, or not the form. So it's a big deal, but choose wisely on your healthcare proxy and make sure that they know what you want. And then I think what Dr. Zesiger said, which is really important, is at the end of the day, you want a person who you can trust, who can think when the situation presents itself, because we want a thinking human being, not just a form.
And I'd add in that if your proxy happened to be in Italy on a yoga retreat, you might want to have this form. It doesn't mean that it's perfect, but it gives you a layer of security and control. Your healthcare proxy is another layer of security. That's why we ask people when they do a healthcare proxy, gee, would you like to have a second alternate person there in case you're not available? And I can't tell you how many times we've gone to a proxy and went, uh-oh, their proxy has so much dementia, nobody updated this proxy, and we can't ask that person. They don't know how to respond. So these are layers of support. Your doctor, your primary doctor, if you're in the hospital, they may not come into the hospital anymore. But if we're in a quandary, we're going to call them and say, gee, you know Millie better than we do. What do you think we should be doing here? And then you can have a conversation. So we've always done that in medicine. We've always tried to, you know, see what somebody wants and follow it. These are just layers we're adding on to say, you need some backstops. You need something there in case somebody isn't around to speak for you.
These are all excellent questions, and we're now sort of moving into the fine-tuning. I'm going to take a big risk and disagree with Dr. Zesiger about what takes precedence. I think the Moltz form will take precedence over the healthcare proxy. I could be wrong, and I'm willing to defer. But let's look at it from a practical point of view, because the question is an important one. It seems to me that the way you deal with it is that when you fill out the Moltz form, and when the doctor certifies it and it becomes a legal form, that it is also something that you discuss with your healthcare agent. You make sure that that person knows what you have filled out, and even better, discuss it with the healthcare agent before you fill it out, so that make sure that you are on the same page, so to speak. Because these are very tricky areas and difficult to decide. I think I speak correctly when I say that in emergency situations, when somebody is brought into a hospital in an emergency situation and is unable to express any opinion, and the staff goes into high gear, what they are focused on is saving a life. That's what they think about. And they're going to do everything they can to keep you alive. Unless, of course, there is something that works to the contrary. You know, I'm speaking as if I really know the answers to a number of questions. I will admit, unlike the child doctor over here, who's only 60, I'm within sniffing distance of 80, and I still haven't figured out exactly what I want. What I do know is that if I were to go into cardiac arrest tomorrow or tonight, and if Dr. Zesiger weren't here, and I was somewhere where there was nobody qualified, and they started scurrying about to get somebody to perform CPR on me, I know that the window is about 10 minutes. And that after 10 minutes, yeah, they can bring me back, but I'd be a vegetable. And that's important to know. So it's very hard to make that decision about what you want. And we are fine-tuning all of this as best we can. But again, I'd leave you with the thought, cover as many bases as you can. Speak to your doctor. Speak to your healthcare agent. Make sure that you and that agent understand each other, and then go ahead and have the doctor fill it out. I think that's the best thing you can do.
So just so everyone knows, this is why we have the doctor, the nurse, and the two and a half stooges, because it's I'm the half of that. Because it's really important to hear people's experience. I mean, it's funny to call Jeff the child doctor, like Doogie Howser. But to hear someone say, I'm within sniffing distance of 80, and here's what it means to me, is really different than hearing from other folks on the panel. So I just think it's really, really great that we have the whole group here. So let's get to the next question. Did someone just hand me this question? Okay, I just want to put it on, go ahead, bottom of the stack, okay. So it says, why are these options not part of the Moltz form? So the first one was, do or do not use therapeutic medicines, like for example, antibiotics or antihypertensive, and then number two, comfort care only.
I'm getting good exercise getting up and down. The answer is, if you look across the country, this form, there's maybe 30 versions of it or more across the country. If you look at them, you notice some do address that point, use or don't use antibiotics. Again, when a new form comes into a state, every state does it their own way. And this is just the form that came out in our particular state, so we work with what we've got. But they do have those two lines again, or as Howard said, you could append it and say, on your form, please see attached and have it stapled. If I had a pneumonia, I would not want antibiotics, for instance. That's okay. It's your wish. Then we better make sure we keep you really comfortable, and it may take oxygen and some relaxing medicine and breathing medicines and whatever. We don't have to give a treatment if you've said, no, we don't want it. But this form just doesn't have that as one of the checkpoints. It's if you're in Pennsylvania, the gentleman in the front row, or other states, each one of them is a little different.
Thanks. So this is a really another great question. I mean, these questions are really right on. This one says, what if you fill this out and then basically slip into dementia or become incapacitated, I think?
Then hopefully you have a healthcare proxy who would then honor your wishes for the MOLS form. And I'm so glad somebody asked a question about dementia, because people that have dementia, they obviously are not often in the position of making their own decisions. And the care of people with dementia when they're cared for, particularly at home, is very burdensome. So people that take care of people with dementia often are spending most of their day providing the care to somebody else. Their life is often seen as the people with dementia is actually a terminal illness. People don't get better generally from dementia. So what happens is the care is so burdensome that they see it as a series of episodic events. They had a pneumonia, they had a hospitalization, they had a fall, they had a urinary tract infection. And actually over time, they're eating different kinds of foods than they were a year ago. They've actually lost weight. So it's very important to make decisions when you have a good sense of where people are in their trajectory of illness. And so the question about antibiotics, there are some people that feel that when somebody has a progressive illness like that, that maybe antibiotics is prolonging suffering. So it's important to remember that there's a whole other, you know, dimension to care with people with dementia. So the original question asked about how can we be sure that the wishes are followed, having a healthcare proxy from the get-go and making sure that they have understand what's on the MOLS form.
I think the biggest problem is if you can't find it. I mentioned the refrigerator. That's the place most people will look. The emergency medical teams in our area have told me that if you have it there, that's the best. The next best is to have it next to your side of the bed. Could be on your bedside table. But if you start putting it in a file somewhere or the ice box or whatever, it's not going to be found. So that's really the bigger problem.
And I think that, you know, it's hard to have cool heads prevail. So I think that it's important that when there's an emergency situation, that there is, that you think about the possibility of an emergency situation. So in my mother's case, she's cared for by my brothers and sisters closer to the Boston area. I sent an email out to everybody in the family and said, Mom does not want to be resuscitated. Mom doesn't want to go to the hospital. So if you're taking care of her and all of a sudden you can't wake her up, then you need to stop for a second and ask yourself, is she uncomfortable? And get another family member over there, because she doesn't want to go to the hospital, and if she's not uncomfortable. So a friend of mine, the exact same thing happened. She actually was taking care of her mom overnight. In the morning, her mom had a stroke. When she went into her mom was alive, and her mom was unable to speak. Her mom basically did not want to go to the hospital, and also did not want to be resuscitated. So she had the frame of mind, which was amazing. She was a hospice nurse, so she had the frame of mind to not call 911, to actually call hospice, and they came in and they took care of her mom over the course of 3 to 4 days, and then she passed at home. So the other scenario would be 911, ambulance, you know, emergency room, lots of intervention, that sort of thing. So I think that it's just really important to give some thought to, you know, what kind of scenarios can come up. And in my mom's case, she's 94. She does not want to go to the hospital. She doesn't want to be resuscitated. Clearly, if she was in pain or something had happened, she had fallen, we want her to go over to the hospital, have her hip x-rayed, that sort of thing. So it's just really important to kind of think about these things. I actually ended my email to my family by saying, nobody will ever blame you for making decisions in an emergency situation. So please don't feel that, but just consider taking a minute to at least evaluate, is she uncomfortable, and, you know, before you automatically, you know, call 911. So these are things that are hard to think about, but I think they're important to think about.
Right. Thank you, Maureen. I really appreciate that. And I think it's really helpful, the actual stories that you can share personally, because this is what is happening to all of us. So real quickly, I bet you the audience can now answer this question. Most versus the five wishes, which has precedent? In Massachusetts, right. So the five wishes can help people figure out what you would want, but it's the most that we're after. How do the wishes expressed in a healthcare proxy differ from those on the most?
You can answer that.
Is this something the audience could answer? All right, go ahead.
Well, a healthcare proxy is just who is going to speak for you. It's not the wishes, except to the extent that you've communicated those wishes to your healthcare proxy. So the healthcare proxy is the who, and the most is the what.
Do you want to join the Stooges? Because you did great. Yeah, but we only have half. Okay, let me see if I can get through this one. My mother had an advanced stage of Alzheimer's. She had completed her healthcare proxy form and designated two sons to speak for her. One son has durable power of attorney. She is not competent to sign a MULST. Can he do it for her? Where does the form reside?
So
it's a good question.
Yep. And as we pointed out on the front, about midway down, it says, am I the patient making this request, healthcare agent, guardian, or parent guardian of a minor? So certainly that person could fill out a MULST form for their loved one who can no longer do it.
The next one.
Where does the form reside? Always on a refrigerator in the bedstand?
So we'll answer that
question. Have a copy?
Yeah. So, and someone asked a question, basically, it was one of the last questions, but I think it's to answer your question, too. Why isn't there an electronic database where this all lives? And I guess that's the biggest question, is why can't all healthcare practitioners communicate with each other? Because we're not there yet. The information highway isn't completely there yet. And actually, there are so many privacy concerns that we're working out as well. So it exists everywhere, and the more places you have it, the better it is. I'll just compare this to what I have around my house. I have 25 pairs of readers. Because everywhere I go, I want to be able to pick one up. So that's silly to say you should have 25 MULST forms, but it would be good to have several. The same, several saying the same thing. And I just want to add one thing. Priscilla reminded me to say that EMTs, were the first wave of practitioners to be trained about the MULST form. So we want to make sure, let us know if your experience locally within our area, within our catchment area, that you're hearing stories that they're not being honored. Because they were the first wave that were trained by our ED director, Ray Conway.
Did you I just wanted to add one of the wonderful things about being in this community is that we have a very involved medical team and consumers. And Dr. Beth Warner was a champion in the Commonwealth for the MULST form, so she was involved from the inception. Yes, she was very involved, and she did a lot of training at the hospital. And Cooley Dickinson, while it's not an electronic form and there's no database, they do. It's a focus. The MOLS form is a focus at Cooley Dickinson Hospital, and they do scan what they scan it in. It's very easily identifiable in your electronic medical record at Cooley Dickinson, and at the VNA and Hospice, it's one of the first things that comes over when we get a referral. I mean, we're very much aware of it, and I think that's because of the incredible communication from Dr. Warner.
Thank you. You wanted to add to that?
It just occurred to me. They ask you if you want organ donation, and it's on your driver's license. It would be nice if there was a little tiny sticker or something on your driver's license.
Yeah, it's a brilliant idea. Absolutely. And so I just want to say again that this is a work in progress. We're sort of on the new frontier of all of this, and we're living through this, and the generations that come after us will benefit from what we've done. So we're working on it.
And I'd like to add that you always hear people say, oh, I learned from my patients. We are learning from you. That I haven't heard before. It's a great idea. We'll email the people in the State House to say, gee, how about that? Could we do that? And I want to mention, we try to have our records with us. I've looked around and said, well, what way can you do that so it's always with you? This form, I'd say just Xerox it, because a Xerox is as legal as the pink one. The pink is just so it's easy to find, and you know it's the original. Xeroxes are normal. I mean, Xeroxes are totally legal. I have a card here that I tried. It's a little card that opens up, and as it opens up, there's a USB drive on it. So people have USB drives, they just wear as a necklace, a wrist, bracelet. This one, being a guy, I didn't want a bracelet or a necklace. This one I put in my wallet, and it comes with a sticker, just like you mentioned. So on my license, it says, please look at my Traveler ER. That's just one manufacturer of this. But you put whatever information you want on this, including, yes, I have a MOLS form. This could just get put into the computer at the hospital emergency room. So
the good thing about that is you can change it and update it because it's stuck to your license for 10 years. It would be harder to change it. So that's actually better.
And she's mentioning you can just update it. And yes, I just put this in my computer and update it if I get a new medicine. Oh, I changed my doctor. My wish has changed. This one is called Traveler ER. There's a gentleman actually in Western Mass who is developing this and starting to get it around. So, it's definitely available now. If you went onto the online and said Traveler ER, you could.
And we don't own stock in that company, but we should.
No, I don't, but I should, yes.
That's right. And I just want to say one of our audience members pulled this off, and I walked over there and so here's a bracelet, and inside the bracelet has particular information, including who to contact in an emergency. And then here is a nice little chip with all of your health information on it. And this is the new age. And my guess is at some point we'll have chips underneath our skin, like our dogs.
It's a bracelet.
It's a bracelet. Thank you so much for sharing this. Really appreciate it.
If you didn't hear that, he mentioned it was a bracelet with that chip in it, and then he got it on drugstore.com. I'm sure there's a bunch on the internet.
So who decides what's long-term? And I assume this is relative to the MOLS?
I would flip that question around and just say, who decides what's short-term? Long-term is outside of that. This is a judgment. So the breathing tube, for instance, I mentioned at somewhere between 10 to 14 days, if you had a breathing tube in your mouth to your lung, it starts to scar your trachea. So you can't keep it in, even though they've made them better and better with time. So you have to take it out and have the tracheotomy. So for that, short term is less than 10 to 14 days. If it were dialysis, you might say, well, my kidneys will come back, doc. When? Oh, you had a you ingested something by accident. Your kidneys are going to be conked out for about 2 months. Short term for that, then, for dialysis would be, oh, about 2 months. So each thing is a little different. If you had a stroke and you couldn't swallow and you said, I want a feeding tube, how long is that going to be? They might tell you, we're not sure, but we see you getting stronger. You're getting through your rehab. You're starting to stand up again. I think your swallowing will come back in a month or two. Okay, that's short term for that intervention. So each one's a little different, which is why we just said short term. Your doctor will help you interpret what that means.
I'm not sure anyone here has the answer to this, but it's obviously an important question. So someone was asking what cemeteries are accepting new clients. I'm just reading it because you are a client. And then can you have a green burial in Massachusetts? So I know we dealt with this a couple of years ago.
There is.
So for those of you who are interested, you can have a green burial in Chesterfield?
Yes.
And I think we might have information in the back. Do you want to come forward if you do?
Okay. I'm a volunteer with the Funeral Consumers Alliance, Western Mass. There's a green burial committee that's working on trying to have a green burial cemetery in Western Mass. Progress is being made. So green burial MA got working find their website. And they list the different towns that there are about 12 towns, I think, that have green burial possibilities if you're a resident of that town.
Did people in the back hear that?
Can you repeat the website again?
Could you come to the mic?
Sure.
Okay. A good source of information would be funerals.org. That's the National Funeral Consumers Alliance that protects your rights and for choices at the end of life. And they have a pull down, it says find a local, and then you could find the Western Mass one or the Eastern Mass one, and the Green Burial website is linked from both of ours because it's a statewide effort.
Do people understand what she means when she says green burial?
Green or natural burial, it's a new movement by those names, but if you think about what generations, maybe four generations ago, did, it's kind of the plain pine box or shroud being buried in the ground without extra vaults, without any embalming, without any of the, some people consider chemical toxins that go into the typical cemetery.
Yep. And there are some religious faiths that do that now. So that's also, go ahead. So as I, yeah.
It's not that it's illegal, it's just that their typical cemetery has rules that you have to have a vault and you have to do this and you have to do that. So we're trying to have a cemetery that goes by the rules that the that would fit the Jewish culture and that would fit the eco-friendly culture.
Sure. Thank you so much. So someone asked this question. It is on the bottom, but given that we've been talking about particular products, I think it's important to say it now. So the Cooley Dickinson VNA and Hospice is a not-for-profit hospice. We're part of the Cooley Dickinson healthcare system. There's nothing here that we're selling, or we don't have any other than our services, obviously. That's what we represent ourselves. We represent the Cooley Dickinson VNA and Hospice. There are other hospices in the area. There are for-profit hospices in the area. Obviously, I think we're the best, even though we described ourselves in less than best ways as stooges. But just to keep a little levity in a very intense discussion. But that's important to know. None of these products do we have any financial gain from at all. So whoever asked that, thank you so much for asking us. We like to think of ourselves as your hometown hospice and VNA, and thanks for giving me the opportunity to ask that question. So next, how long have any of you seen the other treatment preferences become? So how long does that go on for? And then I like this one. For the detailed OCD people in the room, when does this become a living will? So. Oh,
interesting. All right, so we're going to have to pick it apart a little bit.
Is the questioner still in the room?
The other treatment preferences. Got it.
Mid-part. Is that
you? Okay, so go ahead. Do you want to just explain what you mean?
I was just curious to know how long you've read these, you've seen them. So how long have they been? Because they can presumably be very detailed. And then when does that become a living will, which is not the
All right. So yep. On the second side of the form, mid-page.
Great question. Thank you.
Where it says other treatment preferences, and you have the two blank lines. So you're saying a couple things. One was, gee, when does that become a living will? The reason that this is legal is because to get something through the state house, it would take forever. State house,
there's a lot of compromise
and working
forever.
And pleasing. So you could come up with a set of doctor orders fairly easily, which is why this got through
forever
pretty quickly. The Department of Public Health said, we give you the
forever,
you know, the power to do this as an order, and we get around the legal
forever
system that would have snarled this forever.
Forever.
If you kept adding things to it, it could look very much like a
forever
living will. It gets more encumbered the more you do that.
Forever.
But you would still have a doctor look
forever
at it and say, I see where you're going with this. I see what your wish is. Let's listen to your wish. Because that's what we really want. There's sometimes panic sets in, like I think Howard said, you're in the emergency room, everybody gets into do-it-fast mode. But once you've settled in, you say, well, wait a minute, what did this person really want? And we really do want to follow your wishes. That's why we went into medicine. Let's see, and you also said, how long do these other preferences stay valid or?
No, I just meant how much paperwork have you seen people write about their wishes? Because
all right,
five wishes.
So the question was, how much do people usually write in these two lines?
Sometimes panic sets in.
I've seen it two or three times that people write something there. And I've done, I don't know, 100 of these so far. And I don't think most people want to write a lot there. So people are very glad to get through the form and say, these are my general wishes. I feel like I've covered my bases. But there are some people that want to have a living will that's attached to it. Just write it here, and we will follow it to the best of our abilities.
Thank you. I think this is another question that we often get asked. What are the statistics about resuscitation? What are the different outcomes for different lengths of the CPR? So we've answered this question before. Maybe you want to.
So let's have that one. The statistics about CPR, some of it's changed over the years because we've figured a few new things out. You'll see in the newspaper, it was last year, a gentleman was running on Jackson Street. He dropped in the middle of his run. Somebody ran over to the YMCA and got the paddles. I don't know how they got it off the wall. And they gave him a shock. He came back. He was in good shape. He was middle-aged. He was a runner. And somebody got to him in the, you know, those first few minutes, like Howard mentioned. Oh, those are what are crucial. So, yeah, you hear that one. What you don't hear is that most of the ones in the hospital, and jeepers, were in the hospital. You've got all the equipment right there. How many really work? Very small percentage. What that number is varies on which year, what type of person. But I would say you could count it on one or two hands, the percentage of people that really benefit and leave the hospital in pretty good health. Maybe not as good as they were when they came in, but pretty good. Most people don't benefit from it. It's pretty much a futile thing to do, and it's really almost futile out in the community. Because by the time somebody get somebody to you with the right equipment, it's often too late. So you don't really get the benefit out of the resuscitation. It doesn't mean you shouldn't try if you want. If you say, yes, I want it, we would do it. But it's, you know, you're starting to talk 1% or 2% often for success. If you look on TV, somebody did a study recently and said, on TV, I think it was like 65 or 70% of them are successful. Well, that's because it's TV. The reality is it's much less. If you're pretty healthy when you start and that something sudden happened, you have a better chance. If you have 14 diagnoses, you're on 20 medicines, and you're getting weaker and weaker, the chance is really, really minimal that it's going to bring you back to your health. I've seen it work, so I can't say zero, but it's pretty small. And the second part was the length of the CPR. If it works at the beginning, it works. If it's been 20 minutes, 30 minutes, I can almost guarantee it's not going to work. Somebody's got brain damage. It's a real problem. So length, most times we say, we've tried it. We've gone through a few cycles of whatever it is in the hospital, the medicines, the shocks, the breathing. If it's not working, we should stop because we're not doing anybody any favors. Looks like a follow-up on this.
I was trained in a wilderness medicine course years ago that if you were hit by lightning or nearly drowned, that CPR works best with those, and that's about the only, those are the only two situations where it really is that efficacious.
Electric shock from being hit by lightning or almost drowning, the two things. I would say you have a chance with those, but it depends, was the water warm? Was it salt water? How long were you there? Cold is good. Cooley Dick pioneered some of what's happened in a few of the major centers in the world now, saying we should cool people down to prevent damage. And there was an article about a young gentleman, a couple years ago, like 20-something years old, had a heart problem, and they cooled him right down, and he came back, and he was in great shape. So, you know, medicine keeps trying to do things, but I've been in medicine about 30 years. Any advances we've had have been really teeny percentage points. So most of the time, somebody's really sick, it's not going to work.
So another great question. How can we describe, if we are allowed to, where along a dementia illness, or I would say trajectory, we want hydration and nutrition withheld? I think the question is there a point at which I can say that if I am demented, I don't want anymore, even though I probably can't tell you I don't want anymore because I'm demented?
I think it comes down to quality of life, and the decision for quality of life might be made by someone that knows and loves this person. So if somebody is enjoying eating, if somebody is enjoying certain activities, then that's a decision where you might want to make a decision that they're enjoying themselves. I think if it gets to the point where somebody doesn't seem to be happy, doesn't seem to be comfortable, they're not in many ways the person that you once knew, then that might be a time when you would make that decision that you're not going to do any kind of supplemental nutrition or IVs or antibiotics. There's actually a really good tool. It's called the FAST scale. It's FAST. It's Functional Assessment Staging Tool, I think. And you can also Google that. And it actually gives you a pretty good representation of the progression of Alzheimer's dementia. And sometimes it's a good way to kind of look at where people are at. So if somebody has a 10% of their weight loss within a 6-month period of time, that's pretty indicative of being in the last probably, you know, year of life, unless it happened because of like a flu. If this is just a progressive sort of thing, it also says that if you're at the point where you're no longer walking, so your dementia's progressed, you're also might be sign that you're in the last year of life. So there are actually tools that can give you a sense of where somebody is in the stage of dementia. But I think, as always, it comes down to quality of life.
Let me just get this, and then we'll take the follow-up questions real quickly. Because this is important. I realize we didn't clarify this in the beginning. So the question is, other than the Fisher home, where are local hospice beds? So the reason I want to answer that is because we probably should have answer that in the beginning. So I just want to say very clearly, most hospice care, hospice isn't a place, it's not a building. Most hospice care is done at home. something like 95% of all hospice care is provided in people's homes. So it's not like we have a dearth of beds in Hampshire County. Most people want to die at home, and when you choose hospice, that's normally what you're choosing. That said, the Fisher Home provides a great service for people who, for a variety of reasons, cannot stay at home to die. And there are a variety of reasons people can't do that, whether it's the family can't do it. I actually had a friend who went to the Fisher House who didn't want to die at home, who walked out of her house and into the Fisher House and said, I want these last months of my life to not be home. I want them to be here for various reasons. I will say that you can be cared for in receive hospice in our various nursing facilities. And in the hospital, it's very, hospital requires what's called a general inpatient level of care, which we can do hospice, and those people are often very, very, very sick. We can get into the details of that, but I just wanted to add that 95% of all hospice care is provided in people's homes. So there are very few hospice residential houses because people want to die at home. But when people need it, there are beds available. So we had three hands jump up when, no, anyone still? Yes.
Well, that was my question. I understand what you're describing, the fast scale. But my question was, if we're concerned about ourselves developing dementia, there's nowhere on this form that deals with that. So my question is, how do we describe a point where we would want hydration and nutrition withheld, along the trajectory of dementia? And I have a little bit of experience with this, and there, it seems to me that the last thing that people stop doing is eating. People can be completely unresponsive. They may not have talked for a year and a half. They haven't walked for maybe 2 years or even 3 years, and they're still eating. Someone can put a spoon of food up to their mouth and they'll take the food and they'll swallow it. But if we want to describe a point before then that nutrition would be withheld, can we do that? Will it be followed?
That's a really good question.
It's a great question.
And great. I haven't been asked that before, but it makes me think that, yes, I would definitely use this form. And in those two blank lines, I would put something like, when I am unable to do but whatever, I would not want nutrition or artificial nutrition or artificial hydration or antibiotics. Maureen mentioned the FAST scale, F-A-S-T. You would need to have a conversation with your healthcare provider and say, you know, I've seen people, and when they get to a certain level, that's about a, whatever it is, a 7 on the FAST scale. It goes from 1 to 7 and breaks up in little subgroups. You might say, when I get to this level, I would not want artificial nutrition or artificial hydration or antibiotics. I may not want to be in the hospital. So you could actually in those lines say that. I've not had anybody ask it before, but it's a really good way to start to think about how will we help out.
I'm not talking about artificial nutrition, I'm talking about food.
Yeah.
You could say, I don't want to be fed if I get to a certain level. Know in your heart, even as I said that, my heart kind of cringed a little to say, but the people caring for you, say you're in a nursing home, somebody caring for you, knows you, likes you, is bonded to you, and maybe you've fed yourself, but oh, they helped you with a couple bites. At some point, now someone's going to tell them, don't feed you because you can't do it yourself. It's going to be a heartbreak for some staff. There's going to be differences of opinion. And you may even need to involve the ethics committee at that point. your physician, all the staff, you're breaking new ground by asking what you just did, and nobody's asked it before. So I'm very happy you did.
I think that's one of the control things that people have. I mean, it was discussed, I think, at the last forum that was held here, relative to, you know, we have people that are very unhappy, they're on hospice, and they want to die. They don't want to go through the process, and we can't help them by giving them medication. It's against our professional code of conduct. It's illegal in the state of Massachusetts. But what we do let people know is you can stop eating. And so when that happens, very few people end up doing it. But I think similar to the states that do allow physician-assisted death, sometimes just having the control or the ability to have the control is what's important. A lot of people are given the opportunity to take medication in those other states, and very few percentage of the people that are given the prescriptions actually do it. And it's similar, I think, to eating. A lot of people with dementia, they have a change of their diet, from regular diet to soft diet to ground diet to parade diet. This is because they're losing the ability to swallow, among other things. And that's what often happens when people start coughing while they're eating. That's when they end up getting an aspiration pneumonia, and then they end up having difficulty breathing and all the other things. That's when people make decisions around antibiotics or no antibiotics. So there's a lot of common trajectories that happen in the care of people that have dementia. And all along the way, as a healthcare proxy, you can have those discussions with your loved one's doctor.
So I just want to say, I know where it's a little past 8 o'clock, and it's interesting as we go deeper and deeper, and we didn't, you saw how I piled up these questions. That the question, sir, that you raised is an amazing and powerful question, because I think that's one of the questions that's on everybody's mind. And I think that we could do a whole nother session just on that, because we are breaking new ground. So why don't I do this? Seems like you have something burning to say.
One of the phrases in this kind of a discussion that I think is helpful is, has this person stopped being the person that they always were?
Yes. Did
because
everyone hear
at that?
At
that point, whoever is bonded with you and is giving you and
right.
so on,
right.
different person,
yeah.
not there anymore.
So
when people are sick, they don't want to eat, whether they're at the end of life or whether they're having an illness of some kind. So it's just important to remember that death is a natural process.
Yes. Okay, so Dr. Zessiger mentioned that what we might want to do is post all the questions on our website and all the answers, because there's really a very poignant one here, and one of the cards says, you assume that everyone has family. So there's a lot left to get at here, and I just really want to thank all of you for coming and your courage and the questions you asked, and we'll be back. Thank you.